Good morning, Parkstone Church.
I don't normally wear these big things on my head. My headphones are broken, so you've got to put up with this, I'm afraid.
Can I ask, why do you guys always sit on that side? Is there something deadly wrong with this side?
No?
No, okay. We can change things if there is, all right? Are you hearing too much of Craig? Because I understand. No? Okay. Okay, we'll make a start in a moment. It's lovely to see you, but just before we sing, I just want to read this verse that's been on my mind this week. It's John 14, verse 9. It says this, Jesus answered, "Don't you know me, Philip, even after I've been amongst you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father." And it's the verse there where often, I don't know about you, but I see, when I hear the word Father and God, I see God on his throne in majesty and glory, which is why we're here. We're here to give him praise and honor and glory. And sometimes I forget that actually it's a God who so loved the world that he sent his Son. And if you've seen Jesus and you've seen how Jesus loved, then you've seen the Father. And it's just holding both of those things in my head, that he is glorious and holy, and at the same time he is near and loving and treats us as a Father. So we're going to sing God So Loved in a moment, just to remind us that God so loved us, that he didn't just leave us as we were, but he came down and died in our place. Let's stand and let's sing.
Drink of the water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for.
Save.
So we've sung God so loves the world. We know it's our own testimony, but sometimes it's helpful to hear what God has done in other people's lives, how God has impacted them, or how God has saved them. So we're going to hear from Joy now about her testimony and how God so loved her that he saved her.
Yeah. Hi, so I don't have any massively exciting testimony to tell you, but every one of us who's here today who's a Christian has a unique story of how God brought us to himself. So here's mine. Now, I wasn't brought up in a Christian family. My mum believed in God. In fact, when she was a young woman, she was a novice nun for a little while. So I wasn't brought up, I had no knowledge of the Bible, I had no knowledge of the gospel in that sense or anything like that. But I had this vague awareness that Jesus existed, God existed, and Jesus existed. Because in the time that I was brought up in, that's what you knew. And what I want to say is, I believe that there are certain points throughout my life where God did little touches of my heart, if you want to call it that, that made me aware of him and eventually drew me into him. And the first one I can remember is being a tiny child. At the first day of my school, I got lost. I was 5 years old. And the headmaster found me, and he found me staring at a picture that used to be on the wall of our school hall, and it was Jesus blessing the children. And I can remember this very clearly, sitting there utterly transfixed and gazing. I know it's only a picture, I know it's not really Jesus, but when I was a little girl, Jesus gathering the children, and there was something in me that wanted to know, who is that? And so the years went on. I loved reading. And then when I was about 7, we were allowed to choose our own books. And there was a children's Bible on the bookshelf in the school. Great big thick book. And I thought, oh, I'll have some of that. I love a thick book. So I grabbed this Bible. And it's written for children in children's terms. And so I started reading this. And I thought, this is the most amazing thing I've ever read as a little girl. And then read it. Didn't go on anymore. When I got to about 15, teenager. Now, my best friend at school was a little bit alternative, and she wanted to, you know, church bells that you have in churches of England and things like this. She wanted to ring the bells. So I said, oh, I'll go with you if you like. So we trotted off to our local Church of England, which had 10 bells, and we started. But the rule of the vicar, quite rightly, was if you want to ring the church bells, you attend the service on a Sunday morning. So we started attending the service. And the vicar was, you know, an ordinary man, but he believed in the gospel, he believed in the Lord, et cetera, et cetera. And then one Sunday, over time, as I said, one other thing, whilst I was at school in that time, we had a Christian religious RE teacher. And she made us do a passage in the Bible, and she wanted us to know, to tell her what it meant. And the passage was this: rend your hearts, not your garments. And that's a weird thing to get 13-year-old girls to learn, isn't it? But it stuck with me. Rend your heart, not your garments. And so all this time, God was giving me little convictions, I think, and little indications drawing me to himself. And then, as I said, when I was about 15, spent 6 months messing about at the back of the church like you do when you're a teenager, you know, narking about and all of this. And then one day, for some reason, God made me pay attention to the sermon. And the sermon that the vicar was talking about was all about knowing God, how we could have a relationship with God, how we could have our sins forgiven, how we could know him personally and have him as our personal savior. And it struck my heart. It struck the chord with me. I already was pretty convinced I was a sinner because I knew that I wasn't, you know, I wasn't a good girl. All sorts of things that you get up to as your teenagers. And on the way home, I had a 3-mile walk on the way home, and I knew that day that I was going to find out if what that vicar said was true or it wasn't. And I knew by the end of that afternoon, I would either not believe in God anymore or I would be a Christian. I would know. And so on my way home, I was utterly convinced, determined. And I went into my bedroom. My mum's waiting for a Sunday roast and all the rest. I went up to my bedroom. I got on my knees on the floor in my bedroom, and I remember praying this. I didn't know anything about Jesus, the Bible, apart from what I'd heard at the church. And I said, Lord Jesus, I know that you're God. I believe you're God. I believe you're Lord. And I said, and I know that I need you. I know that I need you to save me. I said, if you're real, please show yourself to me. And I knew in that instant, something changed instantaneously. I cannot explain it to you. I cannot quantify it. But to my dying breath, something changed in me at that moment. And then one other thing I want to say that's important, I think, before I stop, we sing again. The Bible says, if you believe in your heart, you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you'll be saved. And at that point, I hadn't confessed anything to anyone. And I was a very shy, you wouldn't believe it now, but I was amazingly shy as a teenager. I would not say boo to a goose. I would not speak. And I read Psalm 22, and I was remember saying to my sister, this is amazing. Look, this looks like this is talking about Jesus. And she mocked me and said, oh, I'll become a Christian now, have you? And I said, no. I denied the Lord at that point, and the conviction I felt was amazing. And I went to the Lord and I said, Lord, if you give me an opportunity to confess to you, to someone, I will do it. You know, I repented of that. And the next morning I went to school, and my friend, who always had her nose in a book, she never used to chat or anything before school much, she just suddenly looked up from her book for no reason whatsoever and said to me, are you a Christian? And I went, yes, I am, like this. And she just went, oh, good, and put her head back in the book again. But I knew at that moment in time, I was saved. And so I would encourage you. And that was 44 years ago, later on this year. So God does keep, God does hold us. Our hope is built in nothing less than Jesus Christ and his righteousness. But I would encourage you, don't just believe in your heart, but confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and you'll be saved to the uttermost. Amen.
Let's stand and sing again. Oh,
righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. When he shall come with trumpet sound, time.
crowned with thorns, is crowned with glory now. The Savior now to wash our feet, now at his feet we bow. His body there would not remain. Our God has robbed the grave. Our God has robbed the grave. Your name is there. Is victory.
Lord, let's never cease to sing, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and forevermore will be. Lord, help us to give glory and honor to your name because you sit on the throne. And Lord, help us to remember to pray and to seek a relationship with you because you are a God of love and mercy, abounding in grace, and you're slow to anger. Lord, as Jonathan comes to give his word today, help us to listen attentively because that God who sits on his throne has just not left us alone. He still speaks. He speaks through his word. And Lord, let him speak through Jonathan today. Let us hear your words, not only as Savior, but as Lord of our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. The angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses, and Moses said, Here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them out of the land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go, I am sending you to the Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt.
Well, thank you, Katarina, and good morning, Parkstone Church. It's a pleasure to see so many of you here this morning. And, you know, it's good that I can see you. It means there is light in the building because we don't like being in the dark. It's a scary place to be. Perhaps now, you know, imagine the last time you were in a dark place. You might want to close your eyes to help you to do that. I mean, it's not difficult for me. Each morning I find myself at the top of my stairs and I can't find the light switch for neither love nor money. And I know that if I get this wrong, Jonathan's going to go head over heels down a very short flight of stairs, but it would still be a rather painful experience. You know, the dark is not a natural place for us to be. You can open your eyes now if you closed them earlier. I don't want you to fall asleep just yet. We know that there are dangers associated with the dark. It's not safe. We don't know which directions we can go in. We don't know if there are things out there that can cause us harm. It's why we have, you know, light switches. It's why we choose to open our eyes in the morning to navigate the world. But spiritually speaking, we're all born spiritually blind. None of us can see God. None of us can see angels or demons and spirits and whatever else there might be out there. See, when you're in a dark room, You need somebody else to speak. You need somebody else to reveal that they are there, to reveal who they are, to reveal how you should proceed forwards. And that's what we're going to see in the account that Katerina read out for us there of Moses at the burning bush, how God speaks to Moses. And how God speaks to Moses at the burning bush is actually really similar to how Jesus speaks to us throughout the Gospels. And I think what God has to say to Moses could be simplified into 4 two-word phrases, which might appear with me behind on the screen. They are looking very concerned at the computer at the moment, so it might not work, but we'll see if it worked. There might be 4 two-word phrases that come up, and they've even got a little action that goes with them as well. So we've got come here, we've got stand back, we've got listen up, don't tread on the wire, Jonathan, and then now go. So there we go. So that's what God has to say to Moses. Come here, stand back, listen up, now go. But who is Moses? Why is God talking to this random person who knows how long he lived ago? Well, I don't know if you've yet reached Exodus in your Bible reading plan for the year. I haven't. I don't know when the last time you ever sat down to watch Prince of Egypt, the 2.5-hour epic DreamWorks film. I've never actually watched it in its entirety. So allow me to fill you in on where Moses is in his life at this point. Because Moses is born at a very interesting point in history. Moses is born in a two-tier society. He is an Israelite. He is a Hebrew. He belongs to one nation. But that nation is currently living inside of another nation. It's living inside of Egypt. And there is a racial bias in this society. If you are born an Egyptian, life is relatively normal. Born a Hebrew or an Israelite, straight to slavery for you. That is your lot in life. And at the beginning of the book of Exodus, Pharaoh looks out on his country of Egypt and realizes there might be a demographic problem on his hand. There's a ticking time bomb, so to speak, because he sees that he has lots and lots of slaves. Lots and lots of them who are doing things for him at the moment, building big cities and whatever else he puts them to. But these people are going to be strong, and these people outnumber his people quite considerably. If those people were to decide that they don't like their lot in life anymore and were to try and physically turn the tables and have an uprising, that's not going to work out the way he wants. And so he comes up with a solution to his plan. It might be what we would call ethnic cleansing today. He declares an edict across the land. If you are born a boy and you're a Hebrew, straight to the Nile for you. The crocodiles will sort you out. If you're born a girl, you can live. He doesn't see them as a threat. If you're an Egyptian, once again, happy days. You're still allowed to live in their society. And Moses is born under this edict. And when he is born, his mother looks on him and says, "My baby is beautiful. I cannot send him to the crocodiles." And so she hides him in the house. This works for some amount of time. You know, it's probably all right when the baby is small. But alas, babies grow, and as they grow, not only do they get physically bigger, but they make more noise as well. And it becomes evident to her that she cannot hide her baby any longer. And so she takes Moses, takes him down to the river, puts him in a basket, and leaves the sister behind, his older sister, to watch and see what happens to Moses. Then something remarkable happens. Pharaoh's daughter comes down to the river to bathe. She finds the basket in the river and wonders, what on earth is in this basket? People don't go putting baskets on rivers. And opens it up and finds Moses there. She looks on him and says, I cannot leave this baby alone. And so she chooses to adopt him. She even names him. See, at this point, Moses isn't actually called Moses. At this point, he is now called Moses because it means drawn out. It's a reminder to her and a reminder to Moses for the rest of his life, how he, you know, came about to live beyond the age of 1 or 2, whatever it may be. He is drawn out of the river. The sister who is watching, you know, appears and says, oh, look, I can find you someone to look after the boy. And so the mum gets paid to look after her own son for a few years. And then Moses will end up at the palace. Can you imagine what Pharaoh's reaction to this would be? That one of your servants comes along and says, there's been a birth. And Pharaoh goes, I didn't think we were expecting anyone soon. And he goes, well, maybe not a birth, but your daughter has adopted a son. And he'll go, okay, bit weird. And he'll ask, what is the child called? He goes, Moses. And he goes, means drawn out. He'll go, why are you drawing this out, servant? Surely, you know, something else more interesting is happening in the kingdom. And the servant says, well, I didn't want to tell you this part, Pharaoh. He's a Hebrew, you know, the people you've been trying to kill. Well, I can't imagine what Pharaoh's reaction would have been, but Moses survives. Moses will then live on for maybe perhaps about 40 or so years without anything too interesting happening in his life. Well, I mean, he was Prince of Egypt. He's now royalty. He's Pharaoh's daughter. He could have had anything he wanted. He lived in the best life that the known world could offer. But Moses is unhappy with his life. He looks out and he sees that his people are being oppressed, that they are slaves in another nation. And so one day when he's on one of his walks about Egypt, he sees something he doesn't like, and he's quite right not to like it. One of the Egyptian slave masters is beating his slave harshly. And so Moses goes, right, I'm going to put a stop to this. And so he does initially put a stop to the fight. And then Moses decides that not only is he going to be the stopper, but he's also going to bring justice himself. And he starts beating the slave master with his very own rod. Moses takes this a bit too far, and the slave master ends up dead. Now Moses has a problem. What do you do with a dead body? Well, the answer's actually really easy in Egypt. It's mostly sand. Easy to dig a hole, push body in hole, fill sand back up. Nobody will ever know. Moses gets away scot-free, doesn't he? Or does he? The next day, Moses is once again walking around Egypt. I guess there wasn't much else for the prince to do. And he finds that two more people fighting. And well, Moses thinks, I did so good the job last time, let's stop another fight. And this time, it's two Hebrews who are fighting, two of his own people, whether they be his extended family or people he knew directly. And he goes to stop the fight, and one of them turns to him and says, will you do the same to me as you did to my slave master yesterday? And now Moses realizes he didn't get away scot-free. He forgot about the witness. He forgot about the man he had saved the day before. The one he had saved had watched him kill the slave master and probably watched him hide the body as well. Now Moses has at least two charges on his account, murder and denying the proper burial of a body. Both of those things will not go down well with Pharaoh. Moses wasn't already in the good books to start with. And so Moses, probably expecting the death sentence if anybody finds out what he did, takes the only option he thinks he has left. He runs. And he runs a lot. Like, he doesn't just run out of Egypt. He gets to, you know, the wilderness where society doesn't live because it's too tough. And he doesn't stop there. He keeps on running through the wilderness until he gets pretty much to the other side of it. You know, it's described as the far side of the wilderness in our passage. There, he reunites with a small town, and he will there live his life for the next 40 years. Having been the Prince of Egypt, he was the king's man. He's now no one's man. He'll find a wife, and he will find himself looking after sheep. And they're not even his own sheep. He doesn't own the sheep. Rather, they belong to his father-in-law, Jethro. And that's how we think he spent probably the next 40 years of his life, the best part. Out there in the wilderness, take the sheep out, feed the sheep, bring the sheep back, whatever else you do as a shepherd. From being 40 years of the king's man, he's 40 years of no one's man. And then we get here the account in Exodus chapter 3, which marks the third and the biggest phase of Moses' life, where he will become 40 years of being God's man. But God wants to speak to Moses, this person who has spent 40 years looking after sheep. And that's what we see in our first instruction when God says, come here, will be in verses 1, 2, 3, and 4. Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight. Why the bush does not burn up? When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, saying, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Notice there that it's God who's doing all of the hard work here. It's not that Moses is sitting around and thinking, oh, you know what I really need in my life? I really need God, you know. I've made some mistakes in life. I'm not too happy with my life. I really could do with God coming in, stepping in, and sorting out my situation for me. No, it's rather God knows who Moses is, and it is God who says to Moses, I'm interested in you. I'm interested in your life. I want you to come here. And the way that God grabs Moses' attention is by setting a bush on fire. But he doesn't quite set a bush on fire in an ordinary way, because Moses would have known what bushes on fire look like. When he goes out with his sheep, he's probably out for a week or two, and it gets cold in the wilderness at night. What do you do if you're cold? Well, maybe not set a bush on fire, but nearby, it's flammable. It's how he would have kept himself warm at night, because he's not a sheep with a woolly coat. And it's a dry wilderness out there. You know, we hear about bushfires maybe down under in Australia. Occasionally things do spark into flame, seemingly of their own will and of their own accord. Moses walking by and seeing a bush on fire is probably just an ordinary Tuesday to him. But this fire is different, because we all know what happens when something is on fire. It doesn't last forever. It's not going to last very long. I mean, there's a bush outside beautifully that I think some of us would like to burn who have to navigate the car park. And what would happen if we were to set that bush on fire? Well, you know, the green leaves would eventually become brown. They shrivel. They change shape. And eventually, if we were to leave it for long enough and the fire brigade weren't to come, it'd just be a pile of ashes, black. There's nothing left to it. Because that's the nature of fire. It takes and it takes and it takes until it can take no more, because its host has died. And it dies alongside it. But this fire is different. This fire is what you might describe as self-sufficient. You know, it doesn't need anything else. I find the word sufficient really difficult to say. So let's just go with self-going. That's a lot easier for everyone. Isn't it? A self-going fire. It can just go, and it should just go, and it can just go as well. And this is what grabs Moses' attention, because these things don't happen in reality. We don't find things which just go and go and go. They always need something. And that is how God grabs Moses' attention. And I wonder if Jesus grabs our attention in the same way. He is a man who lived not for himself, but for another purpose. He was self-sufficient. He was self-going. You know, he wasn't somebody who tried to amass as much power as he could. There's a time when his people like Jesus. They go, we'll make you king. And then they go, where is the guy? Like, we're trying to make him king, and he's walked away from the situation. He wasn't somebody who tried to amass as many friendships as possible by telling people, you know, what they wanted to hear. You know, when he dies, he's got at best 3 followers. He's not somebody who's trying to accrue as much wealth as possible. And at one time, he's talking to his disciples, and he says, foxes have holes, birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to rest his head. He's practically homeless. Why on earth would you live a life like that? A life where you don't seemingly care about power, you don't seemingly care about money, you don't seemingly care about friends. You know, the 3 things that, you know, I think we'd all like a bit more of in life if we were honest with ourselves. Well, he answers us this question in John chapter 6, verse 38, which I've hopefully put into the computer. We'll find out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. See, God draws our attention to Jesus, yes, by the miraculous things he does, but also by his character, that it is a self-sufficient character. It's not one like ours, which is constantly striving for more, 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 like a regular fire, which has to keep being fed, otherwise it's going to die. But rather, he points us towards something else. Something which is different, something which is unique. And then Moses has to make a decision at this point, because as much as the burning bush is interesting, Moses doesn't have to go over and actually investigate it. Like, there's lots of things which are interesting in the world we don't investigate, aren't there? Like, on my Facebook, I get lots of videos of, you know, cats and things in farms. You know, most of the time I just scroll by and go, yeah, I'm sure that would be nice, but I haven't got time to watch, you know, the 2 penguins become friends. I've seen that all before, or whatever it may be. And I wonder, you know, if we do the same thing. You know, Moses chooses to investigate. He could have said, well, I'm just too busy. You know, I do have to look after these sheep. They are prone to wandering off and doing what they like. And, you know, I do need to do some self-wallowing here because I used to have everything and now I have nothing. And I also kind of need to carry on plotting my, you know, revenge or my comeback story, whatever you want to call it, so that I can once again be a somebody. And we too can be wrapped up in our own lives, that we could see the claims of Jesus, hear them in churches like that, this, or from your family, friends, however it is people talk to you about Jesus, and we could go, well, it sounds interesting, but I'm not interested per se. I'm willing to let it stand by. I'm willing to let that bush keep burning and not find out if there's anything there. Well, we see Moses goes over to the bush. He doesn't have a Scooby that it's God at the moment here. Rather, it's an interesting bush. And God speaks to Moses. He says in verse 4, Moses, Moses. See, God knew who Moses was. He's deliberately tried to draw Moses' attention. And he calls him by name. And he calls him by name twice. It's a really interesting pattern if you ever get to read the Bible where God particularly calls people by name twice. Because it's a sign of love. It's a sign of affection. It's a sign that he knows this person. Remember, Moses has killed one person here. But yet, God still loves him despite his faults and his failings. And at this, Moses responds, here I am. That Moses is saying that you've got something to say, God. Well, I'm prepared to perhaps listen to what you have to say. We see that when God talks to Moses through the burning bush, and when God talks to us through Jesus, he's saying, come here, I want you to see something interesting. But it isn't just a question of coming here, that God has a secondary thing to say to Moses. Having said, come here, he's now going to say, stand back. We'll see that in verse 5. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you're standing is holy ground. Now, I think this is a little bit of Christianese in here. I've once explained Christianese before, I think, at this church, but let me explain it again, because I really love my made-up definition here. So we've all heard of the language Chinese, right? Give me a nod if you've heard of Chinese before. Excellent, getting some nods. Okay, they speak Chinese in China. They speak Christianese in Christian circles. Now, I don't understand a word of Chinese because I'm from outside of China and I've never tried to learn the language. And Christianese has got pretty much the same problem. That in Christianity, you know, we use words like holy, sanctified, justified, redemption, etc. We use words often ending in shun, which all are really big except for holy and have really big meanings. But nobody ever outside of Christianity understands them. And I'm convinced half of people within Christianity don't understand them either. So quickly, the word holy. Because the word holy, you know, we hear it a lot. Yeah, there's a song we sing at this church which goes, holy, holy, holy. At some churches, you'll find holy water. We believe in the Holy Spirit, you know. So what on earth links water, spirit, and a song that we sing? Well, it's an idea we're actually all really familiar with. 4 weeks ago, if you can believe it, it was Christmas. And at Christmas, you know, we set aside normal things for a special occasion. Like in my house, growing up, there's normally an ice cream or something in the top shelf of the freezer. But sometimes, you know, throughout the month of December, you'll ask, Mom, can I have an ice cream? And she'll say, no, it's been set aside for Christmas. You know, it's not extra special ice cream. We may have had it, you know, throughout the other months of the year. It's, you know, came from probably Aldi. And, you know, it was any one of 100 in their big freezer there. But that one has been set aside. It's been set aside for a purpose. It's been set aside for Christmas so that we can enjoy it as a family. And that is exactly what holy means in the Bible. Not set aside for Christmas, but set aside for God. That is what, you know, makes the ground holy that Moses is walking on. Like Moses, you know, may have even walked this part of the wilderness before. This part of the wilderness may look very similar to the part of the wilderness next to it. There's nothing inherently special about, you know, that dust. But rather, it's who is there that makes it special. It's God. In his perfection, in his purity, that makes this special. And Moses has a problem because Moses is dirty. Well, he's physically dirty, but he's also, you know, spiritually dirty as well. And God is clean. He's clean in perfection. He's clean in purity and in power. And we all know what happens when you mix a dirty thing and a clean thing, don't we? Yeah, when I've got my dirty hands and I put them on my nice white fridge, my hands don't become clean, do they? The hands remain dirty and the fridge becomes dirty as well. And God must remain pure. He must remain holy. Otherwise, he's not worth worshipping. And so dirty things cannot directly come into his presence. They have to be separated. And so God says to Moses, take off your sandals. You know, Moses has been walking around the wilderness for 40 years. He's probably changed his shoes at least once in that time. But, you know, it's a dirty, dusty place. I mean, take the underside of my shoes now. You know, what color are they, Noah? Brown. Wow, there we go. These were white when I bought them. But there we go. They're now brown. And I've only owned them for a couple of months. I'll put them back on so you're not treated anymore to that. But there we go. You know, even in our, you know, Western society, you know, our shoes get dirty. But God isn't just asking Moses to set aside his shoes because, you know, they're a bit dirty. And it'd be a little bit inconvenient of him to have to put up with Moses' dirty feet. Rather, God wants Moses to stop and to think here. He wants Moses to be willing to set aside the things which are wrong in his life. Moses, once again, has a decision to make here. You know, God has said, Moses, here I am, but if you want to, you know, come and listen to me, you've got to be willing to set aside the things which are dirty, the things which are wrong in your life. And Moses could turn around at this point and go, nah, I'm not interested in doing that. Thank you very much. You know, he could say to God, well, God, I'm trying my best here. You know, I've done what I should do to the best of my ability. Yeah, I've got some things wrong, but, you know, you're not here living my life. Or he could say, you know what, I quite like my sandals. They're rather comfortable. Why should I change things for you, God? Why should I come to you on your terms? What's wrong with coming on my terms? And, you know, Jesus says the same thing to us as well, that if we want to approach God, that we have to come to God on his terms, that we are all imperfect, that we have all got failings, we have all done things wrong. And they come from within. It's not the outside that makes us dirty, but we're dirty on the inside. He talks about this in Mark chapter 7, verses 20 and 21. He says, I think it's in the computer somewhere, Tiago. I can turn to it if I've not put it in. Apologies. There we go. It says, what comes out of a person is not what defiles them, for it is from within a person's heart that evil thoughts come. Theft, murder, etc., etc. And you'll go through a whole list of things which are wrong with us as not only humanity collectively, but individuals as well. You know, it's our insides that we have the problem with. And so God tells Moses to stand back, that if we are willing to set aside the things which are wrong in our lives, then we can be those who come into his presence and know what he has to say to us. So God says, stand back. Sorry, he says, come here first. And then he says, stand back. And then he tells Moses to listen up in verse 6. Then he, that's God, said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face, because he was afraid to look at God. And certainly when I first read that, I thought, well, that's a slightly weird reaction to have. I mean, who else did you think this person was, Moses? And why on earth is your reaction to hide your face on the ground? Well, actually, this is an absolutely massive statement that God has just made. I'll read it again. He says, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Notice the tense. I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Here's the news. Jacob's been dead nearly 100 years. Isaac has been dead over 100 years. Abraham, over 250 years ago, this person died. Yet, he says, I am their God. Not I was their God. I am their God. There's still a relationship here, even after death. We've all had, you know, people in our lives who we say, you know, they were my friend or they were my whatever they were to us. That our relationships in this world have to end when death comes. But God here is offering Moses something different, a relationship that can go beyond death. Because he says, I am the God of these people, even though they have long died. And that is what he is offering to Moses as well, that he can be in relationship with God beyond death. That is the big revelation. That is why Moses is absolutely floored by this. His face turns to the ground. He realizes who this person is and what he has to offer. And as Christians today, we receive the same offer from Jesus himself, one of the great I am statements, which hopefully we'll get to in our series on John coming in the later in the year. John chapter 11, verse 25, Jesus says to a Samaritan woman, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. That is the best news that Christianity has to offer, a relationship with God for eternity beyond death. If you don't think that's good news, then Christianity offers absolutely nothing to you. If that's your case, then that is the case. But Moses realizes that this is the good news. This is what God wants to tell him. It's the first thing God reveals. He says, you know, I'm God, and then I am the father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I want Moses to be in relationship with you beyond death. That I want, you know, to be your friend, not just for this life, but for the next life beyond. It's the first thing that God wants us to know about him. And Moses, you know, has a decision to make. He has to make a decision of whether he's going to want to be in relationship with this God. And as Joy was saying in her testimony earlier, you know, she too was faced with that decision. And every Christian has that story of how they made that decision to choose to follow God with the hope, the promise that not only will we know him in this life, but in the next life as well. And then, very quickly and finally, that, you know, it doesn't just stop there. That yes, you know, step one is to choose to trust God and follow him. And if you've not done that this morning, why not investigate why you haven't in your own heart? Whether it be you don't think, you're too wrapped up in your own life, so to speak, and you've not yet ever investigated God calling to you, come here. Whether it be that you aren't willing to give up your sin and your failings, that you quite like your life as it is. You want God to come on your own terms. Or whether it be you've just never realized the good news that Christianity has to offer of an eternal relationship with God. But Moses isn't just given good news and told to sit on it. In verses 7, 8, 9, and 10, we'll see God saying, now go. The Lord said, I've indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. And I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now, go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. See, God wasn't just concerned about Moses. It's not that Moses has won the lottery and, you know, the next million people are going to have to wait for their turn. Rather, God has saved Moses for a purpose. He saved him so that he can go and tell others about this God. He can go and tell others that there is a hope for not only tomorrow, but the day after, and so on, even beyond death itself. He sends him to a world which is suffering. You know, Moses' people are still slaves in Egypt. And we still see suffering in our world today. You know, whether it be, you know, on a global scale like Russia, Israel, or the Houthis. Whether it be on maybe like a national level like cost of living crisis, homelessness, etc. Whether it just be in our own lives, you know, the personal tragedies that each and every one of us do encounter in this life. Well, God says, I see your suffering. I am concerned about your suffering. And so I have a promise for you. You know, he offers, you know, the people of Israel at that time a physical land, because it's what they probably needed most at that point, and it's going to be a pointer for other things later. A land flowing of milk and honey. And for those of us who become Christians today, it's to join not a physical kingdom, but a spiritual kingdom. Jesus says to his disciples, I haven't got put that one in the computer, but he says to his disciples, I go away to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I told you. That God sees our suffering, he sees that there are things wrong in this world, but he cares about them. He is preparing an eternal place for us, one which will be free of such things. It is what he is calling us to live in. But how are they to believe if they have not heard? Well, it's why he says Moses is told, you've heard the good news, now go off and tell your people the good news. And we too have been charged with the same thing. Perhaps you're the only one in your workplace or out of your family or your friends who know God. Well, God has charged each and every one of us as well to go to those that we know, those that we love, those who are our people, and to go and tell them similarly the good news. It's Jesus's pretty much last words on earth as we get them in the beginning of Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. See, our encounter with Jesus through him walking on this earth and through it being recorded in the Bible, really similar to God's encounter with Moses at the burning bush. He firstly says to us, come here, that I love you, that I know you, and I want to be in relationship with you. He says, stand back, that, you know, I am a holy God, that you will need to set aside the things which are wrong in your life. He says, listen up, because I've got the greatest news for you, a life beyond death. And then he says, now go and tell others about it. I'm going to close our gathering together in prayer, and then there'll be tea and coffee. And yes, do enjoy spending time with one another. So Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have revealed yourself to us, not only that you have interacted with people throughout history, but you have left us with your word, that we have it available to us in our own language. And we pray that we would treasure it, that we would want to know more about you. We pray that we would remember the helpful things that we heard or that we sung this morning, and we'd forget the things which had distracted us or the things that didn't point us towards you. And we pray that you would work in our hearts, that you would help us to recognize that you love us and that you are calling us despite our faults and our failings. Help us to set aside the things which are wrong in our lives so that we can serve you. And help us to be those who recognize the good news that you have. Not only is it good news for us, but it is good news for Parkstone as a whole, for Poole and for beyond, because it's good news to a weary world. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So like I said, do enjoy tea, coffee. I've seen some nice biscuits there as well. Thank you.